evening, everyone. Welcome to Zoom yet again. We hope we wouldn't be on Zoom because we've enjoyed a night without it so long. But welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. We are partly at the Guildhall and partly in our home. So thank you so much for joining us for this National Plan Music Education panel discussion. I'd like to pass over to our immediate past master and Worshipful Company of Educators to welcome us this evening.
Right, hello and welcome everybody. Apologies all round. We had to postpone it the first time and now it's not as we hoped that we're not meeting in person, which is disappointing, but I'm sure you understand why. We may at some time in the not too distant future want to come back to this because I think it's such an important topic that we can't let it go. And certainly my theme in my master's year, which finished at the end of June, was music education. And I think it's hugely important that we actually keep banging the drum, if you'll excuse the pun, for music education, particularly in state schools, where it's doing invaluable work. And the more and more we hear about the effect of music, not just in terms of music itself, but the effect it has on the rest of the curriculum, mental well-being, behavior, you name it, it does it. It just seems to me to be too important to ignore. So my thanks particularly to the panel members who come along to talk about the work that they have done. I think it's fascinating work and very valuable work. The big question is, of course, is the government going to do anything about it? They'd be foolish if they didn't. But then, without wishing to sound too agiprop, lots of governments don't do things which they'd be stupid not to do. So my faith in politicians, I'm afraid, is not exactly at the highest point it's been in my lifetime. But I think we just got to keep battling on. So thanks, everybody who has managed to get here. And thanks particularly to the people who are going to talk to us about the work they've done.
Thank you, Mark. Immediate past master, Roy Blackwell. I'm going to pass over quickly to our panel to introduce themselves. So I'd like to ask Yogesh, can you get us and tell us who you are?
Yes, good evening, everyone. My name is Yogesh Dattani. I am representing Hubs today. And the hub that I lead is in Ealing, and which I have been doing since 2004. I'm also the EDI lead on the subject association Music Mark. And musically, my passion is Indian music, and I'm doing more and more work to make Indian music more accessible. I'd like to make Indian music just like Indian food as one of the nation's favorites. So that's a little bit about me.
Thank you. And Ross?
Hi, everyone. I'm now very hungry because of the Indian food reference. I'm Ros. I'm the chief executive of Music Masters. We're a music education charity. We kind of span across several areas. I'll talk a little bit about that. But we work with schools and teachers and in equity, diversity and inclusion in many kind of forms and programs. So we're thinking about the national plan from quite a few different perspectives, which I'm looking forward to sharing with you.
Thank you, Ros. Geoff, who's in the room?
Yeah. Nice to be here. My name is Geoff Harniess. I'm the head of Centre for Young Musicians in London. We usually refer to ourselves as just CYM. And we're part of the Guildhall Young Artists, which is a division of the Guildhall School, so it's a connection there. CYM is a Saturday centre, specialist training. We are one of the CATS, Centres for Advanced Training, as part of the music and dance scheme, government music and dance scheme. So we have 75 students who get supported directly by the government for their studies. We have just over 400 students on a Saturday. So we're sort of, we sit in that co-curricular and progression route area of the discussions that are in the music plan.
So, great. Thanks, Jeff. And Simon.
Hi, evening, everyone. I'm Executive Director of Music of the David Ross Education Trust, which is a large multi-academy trust in the East Midlands. I've been doing that for the last 7 years. So that involves the development of music in 22 primary schools, 11 secondary schools, one all-through school and a special school. And in many cases, that was from scratch. And it's a really exciting role. I'm past president of the Music Teachers Association, and I'm in my 32nd year as a state school music teacher. And I wouldn't do anything else in the world. I think music teaching is really special. And schools are amazing places, wherever you find them. So just as Yogesh has been talking about Indian music and that absolutely being a mission, I completely share that. My mission really is beating the drum about the importance of schools, and particularly singing, and the fact that every child has this amazing instrument inside them, and all we need to do is harness it, and make sure as adults we don't get in the way imposing artificial barriers as to what children can actually do. So, and I was on, along with Stephen, was on the expert panel for the National Plan. So I'll be talking shortly about schools.
Great. Thank you, Simon. Simon is the first person who's going to speak this evening. So the plan for this kind of hour together tonight is to hear from each panelist. It's, you can see already the panel represents quite a diverse range of organisations and types of work, which I think is quite important. The spirit of the National Plan is very much about partnership. So if you're not familiar with the National Plan for Music Education, which I'm sure everyone on this call is, published in the summer 2022, a refreshed plan, as is a second iteration, it seems to have been received quite well. And as is, we're not going to give you a précis of that plan this evening. We're going to dive straight in really and start to think about, and I asked all the panellists in advance to do a bit of homework, just to think about what are the implications of the National Plan for their role, into the work they're doing in their own contexts, what might those positives be, what might some of these challenges be. And after we've heard from all our panellists, we'll just have a few questions I'll start off with. If you want to ask any questions, feel free to put it in the chat, and I'll keep my eyes on the chat as we go through, but feel free to introduce yourself as well if you wish, say who you are, where you are, and if you want to share any views, positive or developmental about National Plan, feel free to pop them in the chat. But Simon, would you like to start us off and just share your perspective on this National Plan?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I'm quite optimistic about the future as the result of the plan having been published. But there are going to be a few issues that we're going to tease out in the next hour. I'm going to talk for about 5 minutes about the implications for schools. Once it had been published, Richard Morrison wrote a really passionate article in the Times in which he said that the power of music needs to be properly unleashed in every school, not just for the privileged few. And I just want us to take a moment to think about the privileged few, because actually that isn't about independent schools or those that have money. It's more simple than that. The privileged few in this country are those that have a good music teacher and a supportive head teacher. And you find outstanding music education across the country in often surprising areas. But the thing that unites those areas are outstanding music teacher with a vision, supported by head, school and governors. And in fact, that's something that you see across the world. Now that's supported by Ofsted's Music Research Review, which was also published last year, which remarked that across the country, there are, so I'm quoting here, there are schools whose quality of music education is world leading and in some cases reaches professional standards. And alongside that, we all are aware of the ISM's really important recent report, A Subject in Peril, which detailed the grim reality of a steady neglect of curricular and co-curricular music in so many schools. So we've got a situation in the country which is rife with inequality, and that's indefensible. And action is needed from all of us, whether we're a classroom teacher or a vocal instrumental teacher, a head, a CEO of a MAT, hub leader, academic performer, musical organisation, charity, politician. You know, everyone has skin in the game of music education, and we need to work together in partnership, putting aside small differences for the greater good of our children and our country. And that principle of partnership is written on every page of this plan. I'm delighted to see it. It's really important for the sector because it refocuses our attention on schools, and in particular, what all children have a right to experience in schools, how schools can develop their music provision, and importantly, the crucial role that partnerships play in making this happen. Now, in the school section, it has been necessary to articulate the key characteristics of good music education that we believe should be seen in all schools. And the reason for doing this should be clear, that the steady decline over time in some schools' music provision has created a vacuum of experience. And that vacuum of experience has been in school decision makers, and I have to say in some music teachers as well, about what good music education looks like, and importantly, what it sounds like. See, I've yet to meet a head teacher who doesn't want good music thriving in their school. The issue is, hardly any of them have experienced it themselves. In fact, more often than not, they've experienced poor music education. So collectively, we and the plan needs to help them understand its value. Now, when you look at the plan, there are seven key features of high quality music education that are listed. And I do want to go through these now, because I think all children should have a right to experience these at school. These are seven features. One is timetabled curriculum music of at least 1 hour each week of the school year for key stages 1 to 3. Two, access to lessons across a range of instruments and voice. Three, a school choir or vocal ensemble in every school. Four, a school ensemble, band or group. Five, space for rehearsals and individual practice. Six, a termly school performance. And seven, opportunity to enjoy live music, live performance, at least once a year. That's taken verbatim for the plan. Now, I'd like to highlight the importance of five and six. In other words, space for rehearsals and practice and a termly school performance. It seems obvious to us as musicians, but it's really important to state it, because practice is the single biggest factor in making progress as a musician. Statistics suggest that around 150 hours are needed to make progress from one grade to another, regardless of whether one takes grades or exams. Now, a year's worth of 30-minute one-to-one lessons at schools is 15 hours. So that ratio of teaching to individual work is not seen in the lives of young people formally until maybe they go to university and read an art subject. So schools must facilitate this by allowing students to practice and rehearse after lessons, and also by developing this rich co-curricular offer. Of course, that also contributes towards those 150 hours. And that's detailed in the plan, including suggesting that this is a really worthwhile use of pupil premium money. It's not good enough to give a student an instrument and say, right, 3:15, it's our time, go home. This is social justice in action, and that for me is a really important aspect of the plan. And I'm going to make a prediction here that in the next 5 years, the importance of co-curricular music is going to be more widespread and more widely articulated. And that second thing about termly concerts, well, why do we say there should be a concert every term in a school? Well, the reason for school concerts is not to observe the musical progress of individual students. That's called assessment and reporting. The reason we hold concerts in schools is for students, staff and families to experience music as a vital element in public culture. We're modelling it. We're modelling concert going. And we nurture our cultural heritage in the country and in the world of live performances, gigs and concerts by that process of having them happening in schools. And in so doing, we contribute to the further development of community. So that's a plan. How can this be achieved? There's some very encouraging words in the plan about the need to embed musical leadership in schools. That means a designated music lead, ideally a music specialist in primary schools, and a head of music in secondary schools. And those teachers must be part of the school's leadership structure. So on the back of the plan at DRET, we're appointing directors of music who are paid on the leadership scale and are given time to develop the vital co-curricular and enrichment programmes. Because leading music in a school is a whole school and whole community outward facing role. And understanding the value of school music in this way and giving time to musical leadership is crucial in enabling music to flourish. And I'm thrilled that the model of music in schools from Kevin Rogers and Hampshire Music Service is including in the plan. In my 32 years as a music teacher, I found this to be the most helpful articulation of how school music works, the curriculum, the co-curriculum, and enrichment, and how school budgets need to address all these three areas. And of course, we've got the importance there of schools coming up with music development plans. I mean, many schools do this already. So it's not a need to reinvent the wheel, but it's saying that contributes to the local plan. And considering music progression plans as well. You know, what's happening when a child learns a musical instrument is not, there you go, that's the instrumental teacher and we're happy. The school needs to own that and to be thinking about what is necessary. What are the facilitating factors to develop that child's musicianship to grade 3 or 6 or 8? I'm just using grades as a level rather than the need to take the exams here. And that does mean developing the rich co-curriculum, the partnerships with the hub, with local musicians and so on. Now, just before I finish this introduction, there does need to be a reality check that it can't happen overnight, just as a musical performance doesn't miraculously materialise out of nowhere. As musicians, we practice and we rehearse, and we also constantly observe and learn from each other. I'm a conductor, and as a conductor, I'll begin a sequence of rehearsals, already knowing the score and having done the work, and also imagining how that score translates into sound. In other words, I've got, for want of a better word, a plan. But then the real work begins, which is the nurturing of the musicians with whom we're working, harnessing their innate musicality and individual character. And then the performance results from that really exciting journey of rehearsal, of mutual listening and steady evolution. So just to finish at this moment, I think there's a really important musical process that needs to happen here, which is one of partnership. We've articulated really clearly what children have a right to experience in school. And ultimately, let's face it, what we pay our taxes for. But to get to that level, it's not just there. And the case studies in the plan are all of ordinary state schools that have developed their music provision from scratch over time. So let's share that. Let's help each other. And the subject associations representative, the Music Mark and ISM, and Music Teachers Association are really crucial in developing that. In short, therefore, we need to demystify how to do music in schools. And I think by all of us developing a shared understanding of the value of music education, I don't think it's about finance, actually. I think it's about understanding its value, explaining why, showing how and sharing. Then I think collectively we can unleash the tremendous power of music in schools that Richard Morrison wrote about so passionately.
Thank you, Simon. And as you did so too, spoke so passionately about the plan and your work at the Ross Education Trust. Thank you so much. And I'm going to promptly move on. If you do have any questions, feel free to pop them in the chat. But we'll move on to Sophie's Ross is here. And if you'd read the plan forensically, you'll note that Music Masters is mentioned in the plan with the IBIN. But I'll let Ros speak about that. So,
Ros,
over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you, Simon. It was really good to hear you speak. And I think there are definitely some things that I'll also pick up on, which are very similar. So at Music Masters, we really welcome the Refresh National Plan as its vision completely aligns with our own. There is a lot to celebrate. The recognition of the importance of early years, of the high quality group teaching and creative music making, the significant role that schools play, and of course, a real focus on inclusion. The drive for partnership working is not only brilliant, as there is just so much great work that's already happening, but now more than ever, totally essential, particularly in this financial climate, which maybe we shouldn't talk about at the moment. So we were kind of asked to think about the plan's relevance to our work, and I thought it might be useful to give you a kind of brief overview of what we do, but weave into it the relevance of the plan and how, you know, we're thinking about it. So Music Masters seeks to address at their root the issues, or the key issues, that could prevent equitable access to music education, particularly in the context of state primary schools, and that could prevent musical progression for children and young people. We do this by focusing on three kind of broad key areas. The first is around increasing inclusive musical excellence in state schools. The second is championing and empowering music teachers, and that has a particular focus on this kind of specialist music teacher workforce, the visiting teachers that go into schools. And the third is around enabling pathways with or into music for diverse young musicians. So I'll talk a little bit about schools. We work in close partnership with our what we call our flagship schools network. These are inner city London state primary schools. They're all above average in terms of free school meals, and in some cases they're actually double the national average, with a hugely diverse population. With these schools, we co-deliver an intensive model of musicianship, instrumental and creative learning, which starts at age four, so starts in that reception year. We then continue to work with pupils post-primary school if they choose to elect to join our Champions programme, which is our graduate programme. And through that, we support them kind of however they want, whether it's, you know, doing their UCAS references or work experience, whatever it is, helping them even into the sector should they wish to take their music in that way. And many of our graduates actually do go into music. We teach 1,200 children a year, several times a week. All of them learn with us for at least 3 years. And in many cases, it's all 7 years of their primary school life. So it's a very long-term program. So in working really closely with schools over many years, but kind of having a slightly outside view, we do learn on the ground the challenges that school communities face, but we're also able to bring some of our kind of external funding and support and contacts and people into those school environments. I think it's really worth saying, probably very obvious, but the challenges faced by schools are complex and they're ever changing. And I think while I think that the hub model is really strong in principle, I have seen the difficulties of schools knowing quite how to engage with hubs, and how hubs and services as well can actually have the resources or be expected to have the resources to build the kind of relationships that are really needed to embed high quality music education into those schools. You know, it takes energy, it takes continuity, consistency, and a real commitment to building those trusting relationships, not just with the schools and the leadership, but, you know, with the families and the children and the wider communities. We have the luxury of being able to do that because we work with a relatively small number of schools, but actually, you know, I think it's a massive ask for hubs. So it'll be interesting to see kind of how that plays out, especially with the redesigned, you know, the bidding process and how that's all going to work. I think having lead schools that, you know, that's only going to be a good thing, can really help with the advocacy around that. I hope from our perspective we can be helpful in sharing our learning, just in support of the delivery of this plan, and team up with hubs as much as we can. We already do that, and we're on the board of several hubs, but we'd love to do all we can really to bring our learning out a bit more. I think on a related note, there's definitely a question around how schools understand quality, that kind of what the expectations are, as Simon was talking about. The following passage in the plan strikes me as quite aspirational. When working with hubs, schools and trusts should expect high quality lessons from specialist tutors and should challenge poor teaching practice in dialogue with providers and hub lead organisations where necessary. I think that's a tough ask. You know, we work with lots of schools and leaders, and you know, we've done several kind of meetings of school leaders from around the UK who would not know how to understand quality, and are very, very honest about that. So I think that's a real focus, you know, how we can support schools to really know what they're looking for. The second area that we work in, I mentioned, is teachers and teacher training. So from our almost kind of 15 years of experience, the impact of the teachers delivering the work can't be underestimated on the outcomes for the children. Simon has said that as well. It's a real skill to teach diverse groups of children in a way which supports every single child. And given that whole class and group teaching is a real focus of the plan, this is a really important matter. For example, while I think it's really good that we're highlighting the need for, and enabling the provision of accessible instruments, in practice, that will take a lot of time and understanding for teachers to actually have the confidence to know how to make those reasonable adjustments and to work with those children to ensure tuition is truly inclusive of all children, that they can progress in the way that is also, suggested in the plan as a really important part of this. Music Masters launched a year-long program called Musicians of Change. It's a postgraduate teacher training program with Birmingham City University. We launched this in 2019 to help address the patchiness of group tuition around the UK. So we're really hoping that we can build on this work more with music hubs. For example, we're doing this with Wolverhampton Music Service this year. They have four of their teachers on the program, and we're working with them on, really looking at how they can become more inclusive as a hub and how we can help their teachers to develop their inclusive practice. So I hope that we have a lot to offer in that way. Just on that, sorry, I will wind this up soon, Stephen, but I don't think it can be underestimated how difficult visiting music teachers have it sometimes in schools. We have spent a lot of time speaking with teachers both on our course, but just more broadly as well. And some of them work at 16 schools a week, different schools. I mean, I have no idea how that's even possible, but they do. And that is literally, going in for an hour or so, whizzing off to the next school, going into this, tiny room to teach, and then not actually seeing anybody or knowing who anybody in the school is. And we often hear of teachers feeling that they are working in a silo. And it's little things, like them not being given a staff badge, but being given a visitor badge, even if they've been working there for 8 years, and all these types of things that come up, which just aren't thought about very much. There are big expectations about of what is going to be delivered. But I think there are some real key issues around the workforce and the support and the well-being of that workforce, as well as their actual training in delivery. And just finally, diversity and inclusion. Yes, as Stephen mentioned, we have our Inclusive Music Index. It's an organisational self-assessment tool, which really promotes good discussion around areas of inequity, of access for young people, and more broadly for organisations. We've worked with lots of organisations across the music and music education sector on this so far, and we would love to work with anyone in this space who's interested. Please do let me know. But essentially, we're really passionate about this because we have seen that young people, just like those that we work with, do face barriers into the sector, and it's so important that we address these. So just on that point, I wanted to say how fantastic I thought it was that there is this music progression fund, which is part of the new plan, to support disadvantaged peoples with musical potential. And I think that will do great things in supporting those children. I'll stop there. There's more I can say, but I will stop there. I hope that's given some insight as to how we're feeling about this. Essentially, it's really positive, but as Simon said, it's going to take time, and we're there for that, and we want to support as much as we can.
Great. Thank you, Roz. And as you said earlier, I think if teachers came to your flagship schools, they would see what an effective partnership looks like, how visiting music staff can work in real synergy with school staff to deliver a really equitable music education. So I'm sure you'd, if anyone wants to come and visit a flagship school, they'd be most welcome. But you can find more about Music Masters' work on the Music Masters website. And I'm going to pass over to Geoff now, but I'm sure we're going to hear some similar things. as well, because there is so much resonance. I'm sure you're hearing so far there's lots of similar themes emerging, but Geoff, you have the floor.
Thank you. Well, again, thank you, Simon and Ross, for what you've been saying. I think there are many positive messages coming through everything that's there in the plan. It all makes obvious sense, I think, to most of us as musicians, that those are the things that are essential. I suppose we're in this slightly different part from the work that goes on in schools, what we do in a, in what on Saturday, in a specialist Saturday school, is hopefully provide that those next steps, the progression routes, and those the next steps for the young people who are maybe a little bit extra smitten by the idea of becoming a musician. And that can happen from very, very young age, actually. Some of our children who come on Saturday, they will come to us at sort of 7 or 8 even, and we see that there's already an enthusiasm there. There's one or two students, I remember when I first started working at CY, I first started working as head of brass there, and I used to audition the brass students. And a couple of people, one of whom is Elias, who is one of the case studies in the plan, which is great for us to see that. He's just saw him last week, and he's now started at Royal College of Music and having a fantastic time. But I remember seeing him when he was a tiny boy, and another of our trombone players who's now went to Trinity and now is and then went over to Sweden to do postgraduate study. And both of those two who came very, very young to us and stayed with us all the way through, right up to entry into music college and now in going further into the music profession, you could see that it was sort of there even at that very early stage. So it's to be able to give that opportunity to more children is clearly a great thing. And they obviously started at school and then wanted to go further. And I think the barriers are, unfortunately, there are financial barriers, because as soon as you get beyond the group teaching, in order to get, and it's great to see, I was really pleased to see in the plan that saying that there's no, we should celebrate our elite musicians in the same way we celebrate our elite sports people. Because people often talk about, well, classical music and music is too elitist. Well, in order to be very good at anything, you have to become elite. And of course, to get to be elite, you need very intensive training. And you do have to have that one-to-one tuition at some point as a musician to be able to reach those high standards and move through into going on to study music and become a professional musician. But that is when it starts to get expensive, inevitably. And we have over 400 students on a Saturday. The music and dance scheme, the Centre for Advanced Training, part of the music and dance scheme, provides us with really generous funding for 75 students, but that's 75 out of 400. Through the Guildhall School access to participation, we have more support from Office for Students, where that money comes through. And then we have our own charity called Foundation for Young Musicians, and they also raise money for bursaries, etc. So there's 45% of our students, I suppose, are receiving some sort of financial support. But the danger, I think, as costs are going up, as we know, energy, etc., particularly we're going to get hit by our host schools, because we don't have our own building. They're our host college, Morley College, where we're based, there, and then we use two other schools, secondary school down the road and a primary school where the percussion department live. Those bills are going up immensely for those schools, and they can't not pass that on to us. So we are in a difficult position, I think, where in order for us to just exist, we are going to have to raise our fees, and therefore you get this sort of dangerous gap where people could fall down, where they earn too much money to qualify for bursary support. But even then, even though you look on paper and think, well, that's fine, but if you have two or three children, you live in London. And so we have to be, I think it's really important that the partnership side of this includes a sense of how we come together as partners and talk to each other about how we're going to fundraise to support those children as they go further into their musical journey, in what is definitely a very difficult period for fundraisers. It's not an easy job out there, as I'm sure Ross knows very well. So all of those positive things, we sit there in that co-curricular section and the progression route section. So we provide, on a Saturday, we don't have direct contact with schools as very much at all. We used to have particular partnerships with certain schools, but that has sort of fallen away fundamentally, as you know, because they've had to direct their money in different directions. But the children who come to us have great support from their parents, and the parental support when for children who want to go further with their music studies is so essential. The understanding of, as Simon was saying, the opportunity you have to practice, but if you have supportive parents who will not, as I was talking to, we have a new chair of the Foundation of Young Musicians, which is Christopher Warren Green, who started his career, his musical life at CYM and played in the LSSO, and he keeps saying, well, if it wasn't for CYM, I wouldn't have my career. And that was a time when CYM was free at the point of entry for everyone. But he was saying how the encouraging children to practice in the right way so that they have a sense of it not being a chore, but being something they want to enjoy, and the parents communicating that same message to the children so that there isn't ever a sense of you've got to get into that room and practice, because if you don't, you're a naughty person. You have to make sure that the whole process is a thing of you go and do your practice now, because you know, we want you to enjoy this and we will make it an enjoyable experience. And I think that is an absolutely essential thing to get into the sense of enjoyment right at the beginning in the school's work, in the whole class teaching situations. It's got to be based around the idea that music is something to be enjoyed. I think there's a slight danger sometimes, perhaps, I'm not an expert in any way because I'm not involved in that. I think sometimes that whole class, I could see the possibility that sometimes the whole class situation could lead to some children not quite having an enjoyable experience if they're struggling a little bit with what they're trying to do without that sort of more concentrated focus from in a one-to-one situation to get over the problems that are surmountable but difficult to surmount if you're not getting direct help with it all the time. And that is a danger, I think. But the overall sense of this is something we want you to enjoy, and then this pointing people in the directions of, if you want to develop as a musician, these are your routes, and these people are here to help you, pick you up here and take you even further. And I think our part of the sector is that's what we aim to do. And as well as our Saturday school, of course, we have the London School Symphony Orchestra, and we have free tickets for children to come and see those concerts. And although it's not professional orchestra, that opportunity to go and see what is a very high standard youth orchestra playing in the Barbican Hall, lots of those children peer age and seeing that. And we had last week fantastic Leo Zoom playing the Brahms violin concerto, 15 years old, and all those students sitting in the seats up in the gods, as well as our students sitting on the stage hearing something like that and thinking, wow, that's probably something I could, can I reach that? Maybe I can. Mm-hmm. So I think it's the messages coming through the plan are pointing in that direction, I hope.
Great, thank you, Geoff. And again, I commend the LSSSSO. I also get how many S's in that, but it's a brilliant orchestra and I recommend it. I'm sure Simon has lots to say about the sport and music analogy, but Yogesh, an important finisher, because I suppose you represent Music Hub, which very much brings together all the different type of work that we've talked about so far. Obviously the advanced, you know, that progression route as Geoff talked about, that whole class and workforce development that also talked about, obviously the schools, Simon talked about. I want to include our contributions if you'd like to tell us about your work and the plan.
Yes, thanks, Stephen, and everybody that's on the panel. Thank you for your contributions. So, yes, I represent the Music Hub. I think that if I was to sum up the second plan in one word, as opposed to the first plan, I would say that the second plan, in one word, it's all about inclusion, or there's a lot of emphasis on inclusion. And I think the first plan, to use one word, it was about partnerships. So I think that's the marked difference. The other thing that about this plan, I think that's really successful, it's that it places various organizations and various stakeholders at the heart of the plan. So we can all, you know, we can all sort of own it. Of course, schools, the overall responsibility, it remains with schools, but a range of organization hubs, you know, organizations that are represented on this panel, they can all own the plan, which I think is absolutely fantastic. So coming back to inclusion, I actually counted the number of times that it used the word, and between inclusion, inclusive and inclusivity, it, there were 45 repetitions, which I thought was quite remarkable. Diversity and equality, perhaps a bit less, but I think we need to take the plan in the spirit in which it's intended, rather than the actual number of words. For me, in Ealing, we have 90 plus schools, 6 special schools, 12 SEND units, a primary referral unit, and 3 branches of the secondary referral unit. And also we have now over 40 partner organizations that we work with on a regular basis, from the Ealing Youth Orchestra, which is our local youth orchestra and has a fantastic reputation for itself, I think established in 1959 and now a leading youth orchestra, right through to on Monday I was at the embassy of Indonesia exploring how we can make Indonesian music more sustainable in Ealing but also throughout the country. So in terms of inclusion, in Ealing, we are the 4th most ethnically diverse borough in the country. And that's, you know, I personally feel that, you know, our musical offer should reflect that, and so should our workforce. So, you know, it's obviously taken a long time to get to that situation, but I'm really sort of, I think it's really important to that our workforce reflects the community that we serve and the musical genres. I am one of 2 people in senior leadership teams of music hubs of South Asian origin. So I think that's an area perhaps, you know, perhaps we could do better in, but, you know, that's not necessarily linked to the plan. So what are the other areas that I've chosen 5 areas that I think are really positive about the plan. I think it's, and I'll try and pick out a few examples for each. I think it's really aspirational. It's obviously inclusion, as I've just mentioned, challenging, partnering with lead schools. I think lots of hubs do already partner with their, you know, their schools, but I think it's certainly for Ealing, it was done on a much sort of informal way. We would bring people in to, you know, for specific aspects of work. So that's something that I'm really looking forward to, and I want to make sure that it's not going to be one lead school that we partner with because music is too vast, you know, and we don't, you know, we can't know everything. And so I want to make sure that at least one of my special schools is represented there to share their expertise with the other 5. Innovative, I'm really excited about these 4 areas of centers of excellence that the, you know, 4 hubs or more will be responsible for. And I think it's the expert panel, 2 of which are here today, have been very responsive. Thank you, Simon and Stephen. Thanks for the 25 million quid for the instruments and the equipment. I'll give you my bank account details shortly. But I think that the fact that the emphasis is not just on instruments, but equipment as well, is really in line with the 45 repetitions of the word inclusion, because, yeah, that's what kids with special needs require. They need equipment, they need iPads, they need the Scoog, you know, so that's going to be really welcome. I'm really excited about that. So that's excellent. In terms of the challenges, I think we've all mentioned it. We've mentioned funding. I think it's really good to be entrepreneurial. I think Ealing has a long way to go before we are truly entrepreneurial. One of the challenges that I have is that I don't have a charity. We're not a trust. We're part of the local authority, and I've spoken to five organizations that one of my colleagues recommended. All of them said, fantastic, we love what you're saying to us, but we're not going to give you any money because you're a local authority. So that's one of my challenges. I need to set up a charity, and that's easier said than done. I'm getting trustees that are, you know, as passionate and, you know, as I am about music education is a challenge, you know, because these are voluntary roles. Entrepreneurialism was another key factor of the first plan, which is great. I think that musicians are really, as we know, we're very creative, we're very resilient. But I think 10 years of effect of inflationary pressures, you know, the there's so much you can do before you know something has to go. So it's really, that's really now showing. It's the cracks are seen. We can see the cracks in the seams. One of the things that we've seen is as a result of COVID, people are able to work more flexibly. We've lost staff that I wouldn't have expected to lose. And so that has been challenging, availability of excellent practitioners. And then the other challenge is, I think that it's non-statutory. Simon mentioned, you know, describe what a privileged child is, the one that has an excellent music teacher. So the opposite of that is a child in a school where they don't have that music lead and they are not able to apply. They just don't have the capacity. One of the projects that I advertised on Tuesday, and it was sold out within the hour, I only had four availabilities, is a five-day residency called Indonesia Comes to Ealing, because I sort of cottoned on to, you know, what floats head teachers' boats, you know, because we've not been allowed to jump on a plane for 2 years, and what's, you know, and an email coming through which says Indonesia Comes to Ealing for your kids, that's going to excite kids. It's a five-day residency, the culture of Indonesia, gamelan, shadow puppetry, storytelling, sold within 1 hour. But I make it a point that, you know, how do I make sure that I make the opportunity available to all children? At the moment, I'm having to say no to schools that have had it before. That's the only way I can sort of be fair. So what are my concerns? Again, non-statutory and the funding are my concerns. It's accessing children in schools where they won't engage or they can't engage. It's not a case of that they don't want to engage. Who would not want to have a fantastic music education for kids? Nobody, I don't think, but they just don't have that capacity. So in terms of my role as a hub lead is to, I think, help join the dots. One of the areas that I'm really interested in is the pathways into industry. We have alone as a music hub, I don't think, you know, we're not very good at that. But join the dots with all our partner organizations, I think we could have something that could be really, you know, a force for good. And lastly, one of my roles being an Indian musician, I'm very keen to make diverse musical genres available to everybody in the country is to I'm going to be leading hopefully on a common approach which has been made available. It's a music mark publication. The diverse musical genres have not been covered yet, so that's one of the things that I'm hopefully I will be contributing to in the next sort of 2 or 3 years. So I could go on, but I'm going to stop there.
Thank you. No, thank you. And thank you for everyone so far who's spoken. It's really interesting how a thread is emerging. And all of you play such a vital role in how this, you know, this plan is going to work. I'll just spend a few minutes just having a conversation thinking about a couple of themes that emerge. And Yogesh, I'm going to go back to you straight away because your voice is all warmed up. But I wondered if, because you obviously talked a lot about Indonesian music, and I know you've done lots of work in championing musical practices that we don't see enough of in the curriculum, extracurriculum. I wonder if, do you feel this plan it really kind of captures all those variety of musical practices we just don't tend to see in the curriculum, or do you think it's just perpetuating the same types of music making we used to see in schools?
I think so. I would have liked to have seen more emphasis on certain areas. I think not enough emphasis is placed on diverse musical genres. But I think, you know, there's always going to be gaps in any plan. And I think it's up to the organizations, people like myself, to really champion various aspects of music education. And it's taken me a long time to realize, I think I was waiting for a quiet moment before I do something about Indian music sort of beyond Ealing, but it took me a long time to realize that there's never gonna be a quiet moment. So I recently joined up with the ISM Trust to make something available called Indian Music, Indian Takeaway, Rag and Thal Basics, because that's what it is. It's people can take away the resources and teach their pupils the very next day. So one of the areas that, for example, when I was teaching in one of my schools where there were it was predominantly non-Asian children, I felt that some of the pupils were at a psychological disadvantage because, you know, on tabla we speak everything that we play. And there's a composition that goes like this. And these kids are thinking, what is this guy speaking? Is it Hindi? Is it Tamil? What is it, Sanskrit? It's not, it's tabla language. So, and what I sort of put together are some strategies to make it more accessible. So instead of da da, tin tin, na na, te 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 te, I love rabbits, I love caterpillars, spiders and gorillas, octopus, butterflies, tigers too, gorillas, octopus, butterflies, tigers too, kata te kata da, kata da, kata da. And I have clip art with that, and I've noticed that once I teach the adults, you know, and I've taken that baggage off, you know, because we adults have the biggest baggages, you know, I can't do this baggage. I take off that baggage, and then the next thing I teach is a composition that's four times the length and in different time cycles, and there's no, you know, they're actually doing it, and I think. To cut to the chase, I think that colleagues up and down the country are sort of really fired up to make this plan work. I think, you know, and I think that we've heard an abundance of that passion this evening already.
Yeah, no, thanks, Yogesh. I'm going to pop to Roz now, just to think about, as I felt composition could have come across more strongly in the plan. Particularly as it's a discipline that you can pursue with the same rigor and the same progression as you do in an orchestral musician or whatever. And I know Music Masters has done a lot of work with living composers. And I wondered if you wanted to tell us a bit more about how you feel that engaging in new music is so important for a music education.
Yeah, of course. I think our interest in kind of commissioning or co-creation of music or bringing new music in any form into our people's lives was born by actually one of our children reporting back as a graduate. It was actually in a Guardian article to say that she didn't feel that she could really connect with the music that she was learning when she was younger. And for us, that really struck a chord. We're an organisation that we teach strings mainly, and we started as a kind of Suzuki backbone organisation, so did a lot of Suzuki, but have broadened that out a lot. And now we're completely different. We do still use, Suzuki repertoire, but it's, we have so much else going on. And what we started to do was to commission works from diverse composers as part of a series called Many Voices. You can actually buy it if you want to. I feel like I'm selling everything tonight. I'm not. But there is an amazing collection for violin and piano of pieces from around kind of grade 2 to 6, which we initially commissioned for our learners, so that they would really experience new music as something which just should be part of, you know, every learner's experience, something that's new, something that's that they could create. And actually, our latest collection in this series is a co-created collection of work. So we have 10 composers and creators, people including Sir James McMillan, Roddy Williams, and Tom Colt. It's a mix of composers who identify as either emerging or established, and it's a self-identification. And the wonderful thing about that is that many of them are at very similar levels when it comes to just going to schools and working with kids. So they might be, you know, very, very well-respected composers, but actually going into kids, running workshops, designing the workshops, actually understanding how they can communicate with communities, that's new to many of them. So this was a co-creation project. And what we're going to do is make that repertoire available to any community and learner setting for free around the UK. Once it's published, we've got the premiere is at Wigmore Hall in March with Kaleidoscope Collective, and it really is a celebration of some amazing talent, both from our students, because they are amazing creators and it's them that's learning this music, so you know that's why it's so important to have them in it, but also we want to inspire this to happen across the UK. So what we're doing is creating a toolkit, a co-creation toolkit, which we'll be piloting, and we'll also just make freely available to encourage composers and creatives to actually get out there and get into their school communities and build these relationships and co-create. And, so that's one of the things that we're doing. But yeah, diversifying our repertoire as an organisation was really important. But it's just interesting that, you know, quite honestly, that was the catalyst for that was one of our students saying, come on, you know, you need to represent me, otherwise I can't see myself, you know, going forwards. So yeah, I think it's really important.
Thank you. And Simon, I'm going to jump on you now. Just to think, I suppose we don't have a lot of time for music in school, and we obviously there's a huge canon, I hate that word, of brilliant music, which we want to do, as you know, LSSO is performing, and we all want to champion in our schools, but also we also talked a bit about working with composers, new music. How do you strike that balance between trying to capture such a variety of music whilst trying to perpetuate and champion, you know, one musical practice? Is that achievable? How do you make it work?
Well, with the curriculum, we've only got an hour a week. And I think if you're trying to be truly comprehensive, you're doomed to failure because you're going to be tokenistic. And it's to do with the lens that you're looking at it. Now, if we're really serious about the purpose of curriculum music being about developing musical understanding, you know, how music works, how it generates meaning, then the issue of one, you know, genre being superior to the other just disappears. And I think, you know, a good music educator will want to give an incredible sense of breadth, which is also looking at people's own music making and their own compositions and making sure that we're constantly alert to a fully diverse repertoire that we're looking at with all our ensembles. But fundamentally, I think it is that business about at every moment, are we developing students' musical understanding? And that, you know, that requires thinking educators, doesn't it? And I think that comes really back to the core point that we started the whole of this session about, which is it's about workforce. And I can't help feeling that quite a lot of the discussions that we have in music education are sort of luxury without coming back to that principal thing, which is about, are we nurturing the musicians that we're teaching, certainly, but are we nurturing the music teachers? I mean, you know, both Yogesh and Roz have spoken about, you know, what a lonely existence it can be as an instrumental teacher. And there's an ISM report that's just come out, as you know, about working conditions. How are we integrating vocal and instrumental teachers into a school life so that they're cherished as music professionals? How are we engaging this huge army of musicians that have portfolio careers into our communities, welcoming them into school? So actually working for a day a week in a school is a really important aspect of being a musician. How are we attracting the next generation of teachers? You know, there is a balance, isn't there? If we have a decline narrative, then who's going to want to work in a school? What are we doing with the primary workforce there? I mean, I think it's absolutely vital, obviously, that we're giving more time through teacher training for classroom teachers, but we're also enabling ongoing CPD, and the mats have a big role to do with that, as well as attracting those specialist music leads. So sorry, that was a sort of, I was taking your question and sort of moving in a different direction there, actually, which is, it's, you know, we've got to be smart about the amount of time that we've actually got to teach children. Whatever background that we have, our job is to unleash the inherent musicianship in every child.
No, thank you. And you kind of, I want to come to Geoff shortly, but Ross might want to jump in, because I think Musicians for Change very much ticks lots of the boxes that Simon's talking about creating these, I suppose, valued professionals that are working in schools. And Ross, I'm not sure you want to say anything about that, because I think Music Masters represents, particularly Musicians for Change, represents a real, I suppose, a model of what excellence could look like in the development of musicians who are working in schools.
Yeah, thank you. I'll keep it really quick because I feel like I've talked a lot. But it was a program that was born out of us, you know, really, as I said, seeing the need for championing teachers, not just upskilling them and support, you know, and training them as such, but championing them and saying, you know what, you're so important. You're so important in the lives of these young people, but you're valued. And we get that you might have lots of other things that you're doing, but, you know, how can you be a change maker in your teaching setting, actually? How, you know, one of the first interviews for the participants on the course in the first year that we had, I remember she came in, she was teaching in Wales, and she came in and she said, oh, I don't know what to do. I've got 40 minutes with these children. It's a whole class that includes having to get their violins out. I'm there on my own. I've never done this before, but I've just been put into it. I don't feel like I do anything other than babysit. And I said to her, is there any way you can, you know, do an activity with half the class and you can get half the number of violins out and then you can work with them and get, you know, what's the possibility? And she literally had never thought about it because she never felt that she could. And we find that with so many of our teachers who can't come. And the thing is that the great thing about the course, again, promo, is that we are working with teachers from so many different parts of the UK who have a lot to learn from one another. And, you know, we were in Birmingham for our induction week in August, and they were all learning different things from each other about how it works with different hubs, different places, different communities, and taking things away to try. And that was just, you know, over a drink, you know, after a session. And so I think the more that we can do of that, the better, really. Yeah.
Yeah, no, thank you, Ros. I'm going to come to Geoff now. And because obviously it's great that you're all in the same room at the same time, because I suppose you represent all the various components of this very complicated music education ecology. But I wonder, Geoff, as a centre of advanced training, there must be some element of competition, because I know as a head of music, you think, wait, I need my bassoonist to be here, but oh no, I've got NYO that, or, you know, so you constantly, and it must be the same with the music hub, you've got someone, oh no, I can't come to that because I'm going to this. I mean, how do we make all this work with the best interests of a child when potentially everyone in this space now could be competing for the same child to be involved in a variety of things?
Yeah, it's a very good question. It is tricky. I mean, the demands on children's time, purely from the academic pressures at school, are clearly increasing. But I guess that's one of the things that since I became head of CYM, is I've tried to get a message across, and I've never really had time to get out there and get the message across as much as I'd like to. I think there is always this thing that if you have a youth orchestra in one part of London and you have high quality players, you don't want those high quality players to go somewhere else, because they are the people. Because one of the things that happens in our centre and in all over is this thing of, and it happened, I started my musical career life in a brass band, and I was a young person playing in a band with adults. And you get sort of dragged up to the level, and that's that sort of peer thing. So if you sit in a group where there are people who are a bit older than you, or you know, even sometimes same age, who are of a higher level, then that inspires you and raises the level. So if you have two or three people who are at the top of a group, really inspiring young people, but they want to then go on and do something else because they've got to a point where they need to be inspired now by someone who's a bit higher up the echelons, if you like, then we have to be able to give those people that opportunity without the people below them losing out as well. So somehow we need to work out and understand that young people can go to a CAT, whether it be CYM or whether it be junior conservatoires or wherever in the country, because they're all over the place, and still contribute to the institution or whatever, where they came from and where they started. And I think that is an interesting thing about partnership, how we work together to say, well, let's give this child this opportunity. It doesn't mean that we've got to take them away from you. Let's see, find ways of saying, well, you still go and do that, but you then come and get this from here. And I think that is a dialogue that needs to be had more, actually, so that we have children who will suddenly turn around to us and say, well, I'm going to go and audition for the junior academy or the junior Guildhall. And we think, oh, damn. But we can't say, well, we don't want you to do that. We say, well, go on then, and good luck. And if that's the way you want to go, and you see that as another step, that's what you have to do, in the same way that I had violin from OSSO this week email me and say, I'm really, really sorry, but I've actually been accepted for NYO this year, so I can't do it. Well, yeah, well, good, congratulations. That's where you've got to go. So we have to find ways of connecting in a way that doesn't create the thing of competition. We want to hang on to this person. Well, you can't really hang on to that person, but you don't have to give them, let go of them either. We can work together to make that connection.
Yeah. No, thank you. And this is just my final question, really, for everyone. Maybe everyone might want to respond to it before we close up this evening. Is, I guess, because so many of us are involved in music education, who really leads it? And I want to maybe have a think before you respond, because we can't all lead this, can we, in genuine partnership, or can we? What does that look like? Or is there one organisation, or not organisation, what type of organisation which should be taking the lead here? or what does this genuine partnership, the spirit of this plan, really look like? Because I suppose everyone in this room could contribute to a child's music education. There could be a child who is in England in a music master's school. It might be a David Ross Educational Trust school. They might be set up, and they might be in the centre. Who of all of us here would be leading, or is it a genuine? Not sure, Simon, if you've got a view. Who should be at the front, making sure this music education is really working for a child? Or can we really work in genuine partnership?
Well, the principle of hubs is that they're partnerships, isn't it? At a local level, everyone has skin in the game there. Sadly, the concept of the hub isn't widely understood. It's often seen to be synonymous with a music service. A music service is often the lead partner. But if we were really clear that everyone is a member of the hub, then we could really make progress. I think there is a role for subject associations, and we saw with Can Do Music that had a tremendous power. But I'd like to spin that on its head and say, actually, if we empower everyone to feel that they've got skin in the game and are making a contribution. So what we were just hearing about LSSO and NYO is brilliant to hear, because so often there's been a sense of territoriality in music, which doesn't exist in sport. You know, there's a clear pathway. So an individual football coach is playing a role in the national team because they're passing it on. So I'd like to see that, actually, that we say that individual teachers have a role as big as organisations do as well.
Thank you. Did anyone else want to respond to that at all? Want to jump in? Any strong views? Yogesh, are you thinking?
I think Simon's on the money when it comes to his view, his perception that people don't really know what a hub is. I think even within my sort of in my wider colleagues in Ealing, I don't think they're clear. People feel that it's the music service that's become that was the caterpillar and now is this butterfly. It's not. It's the lead organisation, and together with this, for me, it's 45 partner organisations. That's the hub. However, even on my website, it's still Ealing Music Service. So whilst I have my list of partner organisations, perhaps it needs to be different. I call the hub, I call the service Ealing Music Service, which is the lead organisation, and the hub is Ealing Music Partnership. So I'm very clear, but I think perhaps that there needs to be more effort, even in Ealing, to make that very clear. I think my line manager puts out a survey every year, and some of the comments that I get from head teachers, you know, they're very appreciative of the various funding that we secure for their children. But yes, I think perhaps more emphasis on that the concept of that hub.
Thank you,
the question is, should there be a lead? Though that lead has got to come from government education department to support all of this by really saying, yes, this is a fantastic document and we completely support it. And I, as the minister I'm going to make sure that I talk to music, that I actually make this work in some way. Because that's ultimately, if you have to have one leader, that it's got to be, and we're looking at state, fundamentally we're talking about state school music education, then it's got to come through the Department for Education. And the work, the Music and Dance Scheme, and Liam at MDS is a fantastic supporter, and he's not a musician himself, but he's been down to see him, he sees them, and he's so totally impressed. But we met with him and he said, well, we're great. The good news is we've got some more funding, but it's sort of point something, 1% something. But at least it's something, because other departments haven't got anything. Ultimately, it has to, we can say this is a fantastic plan, but it's, as you so rightly say, it's not statutory. But somehow we have to get someone in that role to really believe it and really sell it as well.
That's a really good point. Ross, did you want to have a last word on this conversation before we close up this evening? And this is my little warning to our immediate past master who might want to come and say some thanks before we... but Ross, did you want to just finish?
I was just reflecting on the role of, you know, the boards of hubs, actually. So we're on the Lambeth Sounds strategy board. And actually, I was thinking that actually that's a really useful vehicle. But the issue is that, first of all, we're all really, really busy people who are on that board. And so we have all these great intentions and a lot of things then don't get done. But they, I think, just thinking about the plan and what it sets out and the partnerships and the, you know, we have this whole plan to map progression routes across the borough and, you know, all these things, but it's time and it's energy. But I think actually if hubs have the right people around them and aren't just relying on organisations to kind of come to them, you know, maybe if the role of the hub was really, yeah, clarified, but also advocated for, and there was more awareness of it, perhaps, and it wasn't just left to hubs, which are, you know, they're run by, as you said, the music services, you know, they are usually the lead organisation. They don't have much extra time to do this stuff and to lead a hub. So it's kind of how can they be best supported, which is, you know, a huge question. And I don't know, but I think it really is, you know, I think that vehicle is good. The hub model is great, but they have to have the time and the support and the advocacy to actually do it. And that's all I've got for you right now.
Well, you've provided plenty, so that's really kind, and thank you to everyone. I think, you know, collectively you can serve thousands upon thousands of young people who benefit from your enthusiasm, expertise and wisdom to provide such rich music education nationally and internationally. So thank you so much, but thank you for the time on a Saturday evening to share all that. And I'll just hand over now to the media past master Roy from the Worshipful Company of Educators.
Thanks very much. I echo your comments. As a chair of Vosges 8 Foundation, I recognise an awful lot of the challenges that you talk about, but also I recognise the amazing optimism that people going into schools have and the very life-enhancing work that they do, not just for the pupils, but for themselves as well. So I've come away from this meeting full of admiration from you all, but also delighted about the optimism that despite all the doom and gloom that we're getting about music, particularly in state schools, you're not giving up and that the light is still burning very brightly despite everything else. So thank you all very much for your time. It has been very stimulating for me. I also want to thank you for giving up, as Stephen has said, a Saturday evening to do this, and also putting up with the fact that this is the second time we've tried it and hasn't quite gone as we hoped it would be. So I'm going to be very rash and say that I would hope sometime next year we can get together properly, face to face, in a meeting room, and have a discussion about where we are now in the light of X number of months after the national plan has been wrote, and also any soundings we may have been getting from government or whatever else as to the viability of the plan moving forward. I would hate to leave it where we are now, because it's so tantalizing, the things you're talking about. I'd like to come back, as I say, 6 months' time, something like that, so that we can come together properly face to face with, I hope, a large audience to say, okay, how's it going? But in the meantime, thank you all very much indeed.
Thank you, Roy. Thank you so much for having me came to watch. You're free to depart and enjoy the rest of your evening. But thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.